appropriate to start off with a prayer. Let's pray together, amen, before we get to the lesson. Go. Let's pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time. Thank you so much for the family of God. We are so honored, God, just to be in your presence and be in the presence of all these amazing men and women and guests who are here for the first time. I pray, God, that you will empower each of us through your Holy Spirit, God, to move powerfully in our hearts to really honor you with everything that we have. Father, thank you for the blessings and the thanksgivings that you've bestowed upon us, God. I pray, God, that we will reveal your name, God, and everything that we do on a day-to-day basis. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to worship you and allowing you to be here as you allow us to be here to be able to see another day. Father, we truly love you. We thank you so much. Be with us, God. Be with me as I preach. Remove me from the equation. Let your word be the defining factor of what we need to hear. Only say what the people need to hear, Lord, as your word is read. We love you, Lord. We thank you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Already this morning, guys, it's been super exciting hearing the singing, hearing the good news, new dating couples and all those things. And I know this is the holidays that will be coming up, and everybody tends to get into the holiday blues as we are going to be having our Christmas party Friday, December 16th. And so put that in your calendar, Friday, December 16th. We will tell you exactly what location that will be for that day. As you guys know, we've been going through the book of Nehemiah. Today we go through another exciting chapter in chapter 8 of Nehemiah, where we get to see the church in Jerusalem, really in Israel, really look toward God. And so hopefully to this morning we will be able to get some insights and really spur us on toward greater things in our worship with God. Amen. You know, in the previous chapters, we have considered building the walls. We saw the struggles that the people of Israel had to overcome, the adversity. We also see the commitment of Nehemiah and his people in rebuilding that wall that meant a lot of hope to them. Nehemiah, as we know, was the central part Nehemiah chapter 1 through chapter 7, and then all of a sudden there's a change that's about to happen. Nehemiah is still present, but Ezra comes in the picture, and he reveals the word of God to the people. And so we're going to pick it up in Nehemiah chapter 8 and see exactly the awe of God and see how these men and women really went after God. They were totally invested and really wanting to worship God, as we want to do the same today. Amen. And so let's go ahead and begin in chapter 8.
Come on, Anthony.
Verse 1. When the seventh month came and the Israelites had settled in their towns, all the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, that's July 1st, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men and women and others who could understand. And they all listened attentively to the book of the law. Let's stop there.
Amen.
You know, you see here that there is a transfer. These men and women back in chapters 1 through 7, they slaved and they worked hard to build this wall. This wall was a wall of hope. And they built this wall so that they could see God move, so that they could have the overwhelming seeing, the impression, and everything that they had gone through over the years. This wall meant something. So now, as they struggle through all this hard work, as they struggle the pain and sweat of building this wall, now it's like, all right, we built the wall.
Yep.
You know, now let's hear what God has to say. So Ezra comes into play, the priest. And we see in these verses, we've read from 1 to 5, 4, the genuine desire the people had the word. First of all, we notice their unity. their unity, their resolution. As we saw in the latter part of verse 1, it says, all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street before this water gate. They gathered themselves. They all wanted to be together. Just as we see in Acts chapter 4, verse 32, where the Bible talks about the first century church, they were in one more heart, in one mind. No one claimed that anything was his own. They ate together with glad and sincere hearts, and the Lord added their number. That's what it was like. But you know, it's really cool because you're talking several hundred years before Jesus was on the planet and walk the earth, that these men and women had already set the standard for the first century church.
Amen.
They were already, and as we continue to read, you'll see the joy and the excitement they had about the Word of God.
Wow.
And I want to, and obviously there's that challenge, and there's that charge for you and I, that we need to take it higher in our worship to God. Amen?
Amen.
You know, they gather together as one man, one woman, as one common purpose. That's awesome.
Yeah.
The religious world today, they lack passion. They lack passion for the Word. They're more interested in music. They're more interested in not necessarily interested in reading their Bibles and praying on a daily basis.
Yes.
Music is part of their ministry. But when it comes to the Word of God, how do I know this? I know this because when I get with people for over the years, over 20-something years, I get with people and I study the Bible with them. And sometimes they say the right thing. But when you ask them, well, where is it that you get this from? Can you show me and teach me where your convictions are?
Yeah.
Then at that point, it's very obsolete. They just can't show me. And so what that tells me is that a lot of the religious world, they mimic their minister and their preacher, or their grandma, their grandpa, but they don't have a deep conviction within themselves about worshiping God. And for us in the family of God, I know that members of this church, you guys are invested. But you know what? Invested in the Word of God. But you know what? We've got to take it higher. Amen, guys?
Yeah.
And hopefully through this reading today, you will examine your life, compare your life to these amazing men and women of God during Nehemiah's time, and see in your life where you can take it higher in your spiritual walk with the Lord. Let's continue to read in verse 4. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on the high wooden platform, podium for us, built for this occasion. Beside him on his right, Matthiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hezekiah, Messiah, and on his left with Pedaiah, Michelle, Michaela, Hishalim, Hashdad, Benaiah, Zechariah, and Muslim. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra, praise the Lord, the great God. And all the people lifted their hands and responded, and I want the church to say this with me. Amen. 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 Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Let's stop there. Guys, they were flat out excited. You know, when Ezra opened the book, they listened attentively. They listened in and they were praising God. There was an excitement. All the people stood up with their hands in the air and praised God. And then some bowed down with their faces to the ground. There was an awe. There was something special about these men and women, you know, who had been slaving so hard to build this wall. You know, but then finally they get to see and hear the words of God. They understand that God is with them, because no God would be able to give them the strength to build this wall if it wasn't God Almighty. And so they knew that they could not have done this on their own power, that now the God that allowed us and gave us the strength to build this wall, now let's listen to him.
Preach, bro.
Amen. Come on, bro.
They were excited.
Come on,
there was a passion.
That's right.
There was a passion. My first point is simply this: passion for the Word. Amen. passion for the word. Let me ask you, are you passionate for the word? When the Bible is open, does that fire you up? Does that excite you? Does that really give you a joy? Or do you come in and you can't wait until the sermon is over so you can go watch your favorite football game? Does that excite you?
Wow, that's good.
Amen. You guys with me here?
Yeah, come on.
Oh, bro.
They said, amen. Amen. So be it. So be it, they responded. We are here.
Amen.
Come on, with their faces to the ground. See, guys, the people of our day, we lack passion. I think we go through the motions day to day. Let me do my checklist. I read my Bible. I prayed. Now, let me get outside. Let me go share my faith with one or two people. Okay, boom, boom, boom. I did my duty. But see, you get the picture. That when we look at these people who were in awe of God, they witnessed what God was able to do through building the wall. They could not wait to hear the word of God preached. And see, there's something else about them. Not only did they hear the word of God. Let's continue to read in verse 7. The Levites, Jeshua, Benaiah, Shabiah, Jimina, Akub, Shabaniah, Hadiah, Messiah, Kiliah, Kalitin, Azariah, Jabadab, Bad, Hanan, and Peleah instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. I really practiced on that, guys.
That was awesome.
They read from the book of the law, making it clear and giving meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Then Nehemiah and the governor Ezra, the priest and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people, said to them all, "This day is holy to the Lord. Do not mourn or weep, for all the people have been weeping as they listened to the words of the law." Let's stop there. See, guys, this wasn't just an emotional people of God. These people, when they heard the word of God, they wept. They wept so much. He had to say, listen, guys, you don't have to weep. Just rejoice. It's great. It's awesome. They were so excited. Finally, their work was not in vain. They built this wall. They struggled. And now they wept before the God Almighty. When's the last time you wept?
Come on, Anthony.
As you were praying.
Come on, Anthony.
As you were reading the word of God. When is the last time? Maybe you've never experienced it before. Maybe spiritually, you're not in touch with the Lord on that level that as you are praying, as you are bowing down for God, that you're crying not because your life is a mess, because you don't have finances, because we have all these special missions contributions and you can't keep up. You're weeping and you're crying because you're overjoyed because you understand the blessings that God has bestowed upon you. That you look around and you say, you know what? Marley was very excited about coming back, being out of D.C. D.C. is a great place. Super cold. He was with non-Christians. He could not wait to get back to Tampa. He was excited. He's like, man, as I was on the plane and I saw the bay, I was like, amen, amen. That's what it was like for Marley. You see, that's what it's like. What's what it should be like with your relationship with God. God, amen, amen. Praise your holy name. You weep. See, if you haven't really had that experience, there's probably an element in your life that you really haven't. Your relationship with God is growing, but maybe there's not that intimacy. You know, if a husband and wife get into a fight, there's intimacy there. You're either loud and you're screaming. You got a little passion there, right? Now, with your God, now hopefully you're not screaming and hollering, man, you know. But if you're with God, who is the creator of the heavens and earth, and you saw the miracles that he's created not only in your life,
come on, Anthony,
But he saw the miracles that in each other's lives, that in itself is enough to say, amen, amen, amen. Praise our holy God. Yes. You guys with me here?
Amen.
They listened intentively. They wanted to learn something. They wanted to hear something that would stir their soul.
That's right.
They wanted to hear something that will kick them in the face, as we call it. Convict our hearts. They wanted to hear this. Do you want to hear it? Do you want to feel it? The raft of God. Do you want to experience the overwhelming joy like these men and women did? The only way to do that, guys, is to humble yourself before God Almighty. You put all your cares and your worries and your circumstances behind. Because your life circumstances, if they're not good, will destroy your relationship with God. This week has been a challenging week for me. It's been a little bit more challenging than normal. I've had to spend more time praying with my wife and everything else. You know, I mean, ultimately, I get God is teaching us something here. I've allowed the circumstances of my home not being built the way I would like it to be built from a standpoint of getting it together, so to speak, and a renovation that we're doing, and having my contractor quit on us after we had already waited 6 months. I'm not going to get into that totally. But it was tough for me because so much want to be able to have all my friends come over. I want to cook some meals.
Yes.
You know, I want to have my stove and be able to light the fire on my stove. I've been waiting for this, and I still don't have my stove to cook food so that I can invite all you guys in, sit back, and eventually watch some football together. Amen. And praise God together. Amen. To lift our voices to God and bow down before God. It was tough because I desire to be with you. There's more places to be other than my home, but there's something intimate when you have a home that people can walk into, that you can worship God, that you can kick back and enjoy life and still make disciples. That was hard for me. Because I desire to be with you guys every day. Well, almost every day.
Except Monday.
Except Monday, sorry. They know Monday's my family day. And so here we look and we see the men and women who were weeping and listening. They just wanted to be with God. They just wanted to hear God. They didn't want to hear the radio station with all the R&B. They did not want to hear or look at the Facebook or social media of the day. They didn't have that. They didn't just want to stay on their telephone and listen to their or look at their favorite movies. They only wanted to spend time with God. If you look at your life and what your week and month and years have been like, how much time do you really spend with God versus your agenda? See, if you write on a piece of paper or you really examine how much time you spend on social media or playing Xbox, we got a lot of young people in here, or how much time you spend watching your favorite TV show, and you calculate that versus your relationship with God, you would be astonished of how unspiritual you are and how much spiritual these men and women are. Let's continue to read. There is more besides. Let's start in verse 10. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice of foods and sweet drinks and send to those who have had nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." The Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be still, for this is a holy day. Do not grieve." Then all the people went portions of food, and they celebrated with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made to them. Let's stop there. So he, look, these guys were weeping. They were in awe. They were so emotionally overly joyed that he had said, guys, calm down. You know how you tell your brother or sister, calm down. Okay, you're a little bit too excited. Calm down. But he says, calm down. Be still. Don't waste all your energy. Hey, eat some food with us. That's what I want to do. I just want to eat some food with you guys. It's something about eating food together, drinking together. I'm not talking alcohol. But spending some time together that builds family. Guys, you guys work hard. You're always out sharing your faith. You're always in Bible studies. You got to chill out sometimes. If you can't enjoy life, what is life worth living? If you can't enjoy it, it's all over the Bible. We got to have a little more fun. That one of our most fruitful ministries was when we had fun. Fun equals fruit equals baptism. Well, you know, fun, fruit, baptism all together. You guys with me?
Yep.
Or you can go food, fun, baptisms, fruit, you know. You can go that route, right? You got to have a little fun. I know when we're on a mission team. We our inaugural service was September 11th. You know, we're all cranking it out, cranking it out. But we got to have fun doing it.
Amen.
You see, these people, you know, they had the right idea. But they had leadership. Leadership led them. Say, look, guys, you got to calm down. Settle down. Amen. This is great. I'm so encouraged by you all. He said, I'm encouraged by you that you guys love God this much. Yeah, you know, it would be very good for you to love God so much that I have to tell you guys, settle down. It would be a nice thing to do, right? Hey, you know what, Marley? You're a little bit too excited about the Lord. Settle down a little bit. Let's eat some food. And then you can jump back up, okay? I mean, that's awesome. But see, I believe that that's where we got to be. See, that joy, that excitement, it does wonders for people who come in for the first time. You know, when you sing songs, are you just singing these songs? You know, glory, glory. I mean, glory, glory. You know, I mean, are you just singing these songs because it's just the right thing to do? Or are you singing it because you're so overjoyed about the singing of the songs? You know what I mean? I should not have to say to any of my song leaders or anybody's up front, hey, smile. You know, it should be in your heart. In your heart. Because you're overjoyed. As these men and women during Nehemiah's time were overjoyed. You know, in the Bible, six times in these verses we read, it says, all the people came together. We need to be all the people church. They were in one mind and one heart. It talks about it in the beginning in verse 1. It talks about it in verse 6. I think in verse 12 and several other scriptures we'll get to read. We need to be an all-people church where we're attending all midweek services. We're attending all Sunday services, Friday night devos for our campus students, our Bible discussion groups throughout the week. We have to continue to fight to become that. We've got some young disciples who are not here this morning. You know, and because they, you know, again, you got those young disciples, guess what happens? Satan gets in there and he distracts them and turns them away. We've got to pull our younger disciples back in and teach them, love them through being an all people church when they come together for all the services. You know, we've got GLC coming up in August next year. You know, it's a lengthy, pretty penny to go to Manila,
oh, yeah.
The Manila, Philippines. Yeah. And we've got to plan diligently to be able to come together as an all people church, brothers and sisters from all over the world coming together. And I understand everybody's not going to make it. But if we can get as many as possible there to be able to see, worship God, especially our young disciples, it is great so that they can be empowered and see the excitement of the kingdom of God, not just from a small church basis, from a global basis. It is truly, truly incredible. Yeah. But as I read in the scriptures, I see that these men and women, they're very much like the first century church. They set the example for the first century church. And you know, I know that it brought a lot of fruit in their lives. If you look and keep your finger there in Nehemiah chapter 8, but if you look in Acts chapter 2, you kind of get a picture here that there was a unity, you know, that the church here in Israel really set the path and paved the way for the first century church. But you see this excitement as the kingdom of God was ushered in verse 42 of chapter 2. It said that they devote themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions and gave to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added their number daily as they were being saved. See, you see, guys, the people in Nehemiah's day paved the way for the first century church.
Yeah.
They were excited. Guys, we got a young church, but this young church can be just as exciting. I would say you can even be more exciting.
Come on.
And it starts with me leading you to be like these amazing men and women to be able to get there. And we will get there. Amen?
Amen.
You know, these people, they were resolved. They were resolved. They weren't in a hurry to leave. They weren't in a hurry to leave at all. As we continue to read. In verse 13. On the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, gathered around Ezra the teacher to give attention to the words of the law. They found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded through Moses, that the Israelites were to live in temporary shelters during the festival of the seventh month, and that they should proclaim this word and spread it throughout the towns in Jerusalem. Go out into the hill country and bring back the branches and olives and wild olive trees from the myrtles and palms and the shade trees to make temporary shelters, as it is written. So the people went out and brought back the branches and built themselves temporary shelters on their own roofs, in their courtyards, in the courts of the house of God, and the square by the water gate, and the one by the gate of Ephraim. The whole company had returned from the exile, built temporary shelters, and lived in them. From the days of Joshua, son of Nun, until today, the Israelites had not celebrated like this. And their joy was very great. Day after day, from the first day to the last, Ezra read from the book of the law of God. They celebrated the festival for 7 days, and on the eighth day, in accordance with the regulation, there was an assembly. You get to see, day after day, for 7 days, they celebrated. They wasn't in a rush to get out of service. They did not come hoping that this would end soon. They had come here to hear the word of God. You know, some like the super spiritual disciples we have in here today. You know, they can't wait for NFL today to see their Raiders, right, Chris? To see their Buffalo Bills, right, Ray? To see the Detroit Lions, right, William?
Absolutely not.
And then maybe to really see the Saints. Our whole NFC South, first time I've known, are taking over the whole entire TV station today. All the NFC South is on television.
Wow.
Yeah.
And even Sunday night, the NFC South is on television.
Come on, Anthony.
And you know, that really fires me up. But someone has to tell me, Anthony, settle down. Settle down. Because the only thing I care about is everybody else but the Saints. Winning. Everybody else losing except the Saints. And for the first time, Carolina is on TV, taking over TV. Atlanta is taking over TV. Saints is taking over TV. And Tampa is taking over the TV today. No other shows on TV, unless you have DirecTV. But I'm not going to go there because that's not the top of my lesson. My point here is simply this. See, I was getting a little bit excited talking about that. You see that, guys? You see how easy it is to get distracted when you get excited about something? But see, they weren't in a hurry to leave. You know, if I went to 2 o'clock today and I preached for 2 o'clock, some of you would have fallen away, nearly fallen away in your heart. You guys with me here? You guys expect me at 11:45 to finish every Sunday at least, or earlier. But see, these incredible men and women of God, they were up all night, noon, till the late nights, listening to God, weeping and praising, because they were so fired up. They were so involved in wanting to know and understand who their God is. Do you understand who your God is? It's amazing. The people were paying attention to what the Word of God had to say to them as Ezra was preaching to them. They actually desired to hear it and receive it. It's amazing. Our churches would be far better today if God's people would hear and obey His word. You know, Christmas is coming up. Do people really know what the whole idea of Christmas is? Do they understand what Jesus is all about? How do they really understand or know who Jesus is? But they worship God, or they say they do. They get all the gifts. They run, as Ray said, to the Black Friday, and they're all over the place. But do they really understand what Christmas is? And I want to challenge the church. You know, it's great to have fun and celebrate Christmas, the idea of Jesus, you know, risen from the dead, and you know, the idea of Jesus being born ultimately, and you know, all those things are great. But you don't want to lose perspective of why we do what we do. You don't want to lose perspective in who the King is. You don't want to get so invested in the things of the world that you miss out on the holiness of God, the worshiping Him with all your heart, praying to weep for Him, beg for God to give you the insight so that you could fall deeper in love, so that you could impact His people, His chosen people, His royal priesthood, His holy nation, His people called out for the common purpose. You don't want to miss those things. Point number two, passionate preaching of the word. Passionate preaching of the word. You know, we saw earlier there in verse 6, where Ezra prayed to the Lord, the God. All the people lifted their hands and they responded. You know, Ezra was a student of the scriptures. And so he used his God-given talent to spur these men and women on. You know, they were excited. They wept. And Ezra chapter 7 talks about it. Verse 10 says, "For Ezra had devoted himself to the study and observance of the law of God, and to the teachings, its decrees, and law in Israel." See, before Ezra even read this, we see earlier, even in Ezra, that this guy was a man that really loved the word of God. The question is this your heart when it comes to your devotion to the word of God daily? Is this your heart? If it's not, you can change this. You can change it. You want to be joyful? You want to be happy? You want to impact people? Then let your joy shine through your personal Bible studies that you've inquired for yourself. Let it change your life. You see Ezra stand up at the pulpit, this wood pulpit, for the purpose of making sure that people saw him, people listened to him. He caught their attention, and they were in awe. You know, 1 Corinthians 1:21, kind of gives us some insight here. You don't have to turn there, you can just listen. It says, for since the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him. God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Ezra had that same desire, the desire to preach to those people who were foolish to be able to save them. Is that your passion? See, passionate preaching that gives us hope. That's what it's about, guys. Passionate preaching that gives us hope. Modern society had gotten away from the Bible preaching, guys, and bringing the word to the people of God. Preaching is essential for worship. And I want to call anyone who calls themselves disciple, and you are a disciple, I want to challenge you to preach the word. Amen. At every opportunity you have, preach the word. Amen. It is the word of God that changes lives. Your friendships, eating dinners with them, those are just the bonus. But when you sit down and you study the Bible with people and you help them to see something that they've never seen before, then you give them some insights from the Word of God, it changes lives. It doesn't matter how you look, doesn't matter how you speak, doesn't matter how sharp you dress with the clothes you wear, it's all about preaching the Word. It doesn't matter how well you cook the food and delicacies for people to eat. It's all about the Word of God. Amen, guys? Amen. You guys with me here?
Yeah.
Point number three, passionate praising that inspires God. Passionate praising that inspires God. We said earlier, you heard the people say amen in verse 6. As the word was read and preached, it brought rejoicing to the hearts of the people. They lifted their hands and they rejoiced. The Bible had brought comfort to them. It brought comfort to them. They rejoiced because they were no longer, they saw that I would no longer even get my security from my circumstances, from my talents, from what people say about me or how people build me up, that I'm going to get my security from God Almighty.
Come on.
The same way they rejoice, my brothers and sisters, the same way you can rejoice. What can we rejoice in? We can rejoice that we have friendships that are truly real. Amen?
Yeah.
We have discipling partners like Ray and Chris, Luke who disciples Elizabeth and I from afar. You know, we have people that we can confess our sin on a daily basis. That's exciting, so that we can be healed. That's what it says. To confess your sins so that you may be healed. You know, we've got people that we can actually cry with. I've cried, and you've cried in front of you guys many times. I've cried with some of you guys many times because of our love and our bond. We can do this and not feel shameful of doing those things. You know, we speak the truth in love. When we see sin, we call it out with love so that we can help turn someone around. It's not easy. It's hard at times, but that's what the kind of friendships we have in our church today. You know, we also rebuke one another. When someone is in some serious sin, we rebuke the snot out of them so that they can turn around and change. I know that word snot is not a great thing, but I want to give you a visual there because you know how that, you know what that looks like. It's the sin that is awful that's in our heart. You love the sinner, hate the sin. Amen, guys? And so a nice little rebuke is awesome. At times, pulling people back to God. Amen. You know, relationships here that are built on purity, about the Word of God. You know, men and women could actually go on dates and be pure. That's Ray and Carrie Ann would not have been dating at this point if there were some issues in that area. But I can say, I vouch for Ray. Ray is a pure man. And so God has rewarded Ray because of his purity. Amen. And I know that God wants to continue to reward us in many areas of our lives. Amen?
Yeah.
You know, we look again, we see these people in verse 8. They read the book of the law distinctly. They gave them a sense of cause for their lives. Guys, we have a sense of cause when we've made the decision to become disciples. The question I have for you this morning, are you hungry for more of the word? Are you hungry? Do you eat it? Do you sleep it? Do you dream about the word? We've got to become more and more spiritual in that way. The only way is to humble ourselves, surrender to him, pray, fast, beg God to love him more and more, and do obedience. That's how we fall in love with God, because when you obey, you see the miracles, because God gives us openly the miracles. He gives us and shows us what His plan is, and as we are obedient to Him, the miracles happen. They may not necessarily always happen when you want them to happen, but if you persevere and you've been tested by the fire and you don't fall away, you don't give up, the miracles will happen and you will be abundantly fruitful and you will continue to be blessed. Amen?
Amen.
It's okay. Let me show you guys how to clap. Anyway. It's not that I want to clap, but sometimes we don't know when to clap, or maybe we're convicted. I don't know. But anyway, guys, when you clap, you know, you see Kit McCain, bro. He's passionate. I mean, yeah. I'd be passionate, bro. When you clap, everything you do, you sing passionate, even if you can't sing. Holy, holy, hallelujah. I mean, you just sing it out. It's awesome. But see, you know, people, when you're worshiping God, you know, this is one sister who went steady yesterday. I mean, I'll tell you what her name is. But this, she sings with all of her heart. I mean, it's awesome. She may not be the best singer, but she sings with passion.
Every time.
She makes some joyful noises. See, guys, most of us are pretty good. Most of us are pretty good at just being a part of things in the church. But when we come to devos, Bible talks, and different things like that, guys, we just every time we come in the door, we need to be passionate. We need to come in, have our quiet times before we come in, the walk in the building. You know, I appreciate Heather. Every time I see Heather, I see Heather. She's, you know, no matter what she's doing, she makes sure, I've seen it lately, she's having her quiet time before church. I always see her having her quiet time. Before, I didn't see that. And sometimes, I think in the beginning, she missed her quiet times before. But now she's repented of that. She has her quiet times. And before she walks in the church, I see her having her quiet times because she's obedient. She knows she's obedient to Jesus, because the Bible says in Mark 1:35, very early in the morning while it was still dark, Jesus got up and he prayed. Amen. He spent time with the Lord, and we need to spend time with the Lord. We need to be a passionate people for the word. We need to be a passionate preacher that gives hope to the people. We need to be passionate praising that inspires the people of the world to God be the glory.